It's time to turn this into this. This is one episode many people have been asking for. But before I get technical, let me be clear with this. I am not a medical professional. I was a sound engineer and live production director. Researching the specifications and design differences was something I enjoyed, also influenced my personal decision greatly. You have a choice. There is more than one manufacturer out there, and they do vary quite differently in their design and features. It is important to note that some differences may warrant your audiologist or surgeon recommending a particular implant to you for a valid medical reason. Technical specifications are simply another language to most people, yet they can be the make or break difference between brand A or brand B. I'm hoping my professional background will help me translate this into a simpler English for you. Sometimes salespeople use specifications to confuse us or to manipulate us with hard-to-explain, irrelevant little truths. So convinced that the bigger numbers mean better results, and because the numbers are bigger, who are we to argue? Sound systems are a classic example. Bigger wattage and power outputs does not mean you are supposed to play them at earth-shattering levels, but it can mean that with all that power, you will get better quality sound at normal listening levels. Four-cylinder cars versus V8s. Bigger engines mean faster cars, but it doesn't change the speed limits on the roads we drive. More power can give you more control, but in the wrong hands, it can certainly get you into trouble quickly. Having a bigger engine and more power doesn't make you a better driver. With cochlear implants, bigger numbers won't change key factors, like the speed limit your brain converts electrical pulses into sound. There are two major components to a cochlear implant, the external processor and the implanted electrode array. The electrode array is the one thing that you cannot easily change in the future, and of course, you hope you never have to. So that became the major component I based my personal decision on. Technology changes so rapidly that the external processors will forever be improving and updating, regardless of which brand you choose. The implant, well, that's a one-time choice and the point of no return. So let's focus on that today. The main electrode array specifications that you read are the maximum stimulation rate, also known as pulses per second, the number of electrodes, how many channels, MRI compatibility, EAS or hybrid compatible, its weight, yes, how heavy is it, and its length. That was a key factor for me. An important fact to understand about the anatomy of your cochlea, it picks up different frequencies in different areas. The high frequencies being at the entrance closest to the eardrum, going all the way down to the low frequencies at the inner apex. So let's start at the top. Pulses per second. In the sound industry, companies always put the wattage first. How loud can it go? Cars are all about horsepower, or 0 to 100. Well, PPS was listed first, so I could only presume it was really important. I spent weeks researching, asking ENTs, audiologists, and manufacturers why was it so important. Because the numbers varied greatly. Advanced Bionics have a staggering 83,000 PPS, while Cochlear come in fourth with 32,000. So I asked what I thought was an obvious question. How many pulses per second can my brain and auditory nervous system actually process? Would you believe no one that I spoke to could give me an accurate answer? In fact, some people said,
Gee, That's actually a good question.
I did get very similar answers from two senior audiologists who worked for different manufacturers.
So far, we have found no benefit to increase the PPS of our processors above 2500. In fact, most people seem to have optimized results around 1500 to 2000 pulses per second.
MRI compatibility is a big one that concerns a lot of people. When recording this episode, Advanced Bionics, Cochlear Limited, Medel, and Oticon all have 3 Tesla MRI compatible implants. For some manufacturers, that is a very recent achievement. So if you are already implanted, it is important to know that MRI machines vary in power from 1.5 Tesla to 3 Tesla, in rare situations, 6 Tesla. And not all older electrode arrays are 3 Tesla safe. For some brands, older implants may have to have the magnet removed, so find out what your implant can withstand before proceeding. Some specifications are more for the surgeons and fitting the device to you. We are all different, so I don't see the need to go into detail with all of them. If you do want to ask me a question, I'm happy to answer it. Soon I will release part 2 of this episode, and it will focus on the external processors, and also talk about EAS and hybrid systems, which occur with residual hearing. I'm also looking forward to doing a dedicated episode on streaming devices. Listen to your medical professionals. If you have a hearing loss and you are considering a cochlear implant, there may be a very good reason why an audiologist or surgeon may suggest a specific brand to you. I truly believe that with today's technology, there really is no wrong choice. Not if the result is you coming back to the world of sound or experiencing sound for the very first time.
Triple tone. I just heard a switch on tone. Da-da-da-da.
You can find me at mycochlearjourney.com. Don't forget to subscribe, and until next time, take care.